Hello everyone, so I welcome you all to this short video explaining about the ninth cranial nerve, that is glossopharyngeal nerve. So here in this video we are going to learn about the various nuclei related to the glossopharyngeal nerve, then various functional components of glossopharyngeal nerve and the course of this particular nerve. Under the course we will explain two parts, intracranial course and extracranial course. Then we will learn various branches and the distribution of these branches to various sites. At the end, we will explain the clinical aspects of the glossopharyngeal nerve. The glossopharyngeal nerve is a mixed nerve that consists of sensory components and motor components. The sensory component is large because that contains more number of neurons, and the motor component is comparatively smaller that consists of less number of motor neurons, and this small motor component supplies to a muscle called as stylopharyngeus muscle. The glossopharyngeal nerve is the nerve of third branchial arch or third pharyngeal arch. And this particular nerve in its course got two ganglia. These are sensory ganglia. One is above and one is below. So these are called as superior ganglion and inferior ganglion respectively. Now let us analyze what are the various functional components of glossopharyngeal nerve. This glossopharyngeal nerve got various functional components like special visceral efferent fibers. As the name suggests to you, these fibers are efferent, which are coming down, and these special visceral efferent fibers are coming from nucleus ambiguus, and these fibers are motor to the muscle called as stylopharyngeus muscle. Second component is general visceral efferent fibers. So this general visceral efferent fibers carries the secretomotor fibers to a salivary gland called as parotid gland. And these fibers which are coming through the glossopharyngeal nerve, that will be relaying in the otic ganglion. Further, that will reach to the parotid gland through the auriculotemporal nerve. Next functional component is general visceral afferent fibers. And these fibers are carrying sensations from various sites like posterior one-third of the tongue, including circumvallate papillae, and also from the palatine tonsils, and also other sensations from the carotid body and carotid sinus. So these are the baro and chemoreceptors. From these receptors also the sensations are carried through the glossopharyngeal nerve. Other than these, from the auditory tube or from the eustachian tube, and also from the middle ear cavity, the sensations are carried through the glossopharyngeal nerve fibers. Next functional components are special visceral afferent. So these special visceral afferent fibers are carrying the special sensation, that is the taste sensation, from the posterior one third of the tongue, and also from the circumvallate papillae. Now let us learn what are the various nuclei which are related to the glossopharyngeal nerve. First to explain is nucleus ambiguus. So the fibers arising from the nucleus ambiguus, these fibers are motor fibers. These motor fibers are supplying to a muscle called as stylopharyngeus muscle. Second nucleus to explain is inferior salivatory nucleus. So the fibers arising from the inferior salivatory nucleus, so these fibers are reaching to the otic ganglion, and further in the otic ganglion these neuronal fibers are synapsing, and through the auriculotemporal nerve these impulses are reaching to the parotid gland. So from the inferior salivatory nucleus the secretomotor fibers are coming to the parotid gland. The third nucleus to explain is the nucleus of tractus solitarius. So this nucleus of tractus solitarius that receives the sensory fibers, that is the special sensations from the circumvallate papillae of the tongue and also from the posterior one-third region of the tongue. Further, we have spinal nucleus of fifth cranial nerve that receives the general sensation from posterior one-third of the tongue. So these are the nuclei which are related to the glossopharyngeal nerve. Next, let us explain the course of glossopharyngeal nerve. Under the course, we will explain two headings. So we have to explain the intracranial course, that is within the cranial cavity, and extracranial course, that is outside the cranial cavity. So first, let us see the intracranial course in detail. So that is within the cranial cavity. Remember, from the nuclei, the fibers of the glossopharyngeal nerves emerges as nerve rootlets, and these nerve rootlets are emerging out from the medulla of the brainstem, exactly speaking at the posterolateral sulcus between olive and inferior cerebellar peduncle. So that's the area where glossopharyngeal nerve is emerging out. So these nerve rootlets of glossopharyngeal nerve, these are located just above the vagal nerve rootlets. So below you have the vagus nerve rootlets and above you have the glossopharyngeal nerve rootlets. Further, all these rootlets are joining to form a common trunk of glossopharyngeal nerve. And this trunk of glossopharyngeal nerve will be running further forwards and laterally, and it will be targeting the jugulo-foramen. Further, this nerve passes through the middle part of jugulo-foramen. So in the jugulo-foramen, we have already learned various structures are passing through the jugulo-foramen. So we were dividing to anterior, middle and posterior compartments of jugulo-foramen. And the glossopharyngeal nerve is passing through the middle compartment. There are other nerves which are accompanying the glossopharyngeal nerve here in the jugular foramen. These are the vagus nerve and accessory nerve. But here, for the glossopharyngeal nerve in the jugular foramen, that will be with a separate dural sheath. So this is located just anterior to the vagus nerve and accessory nerve. So this is the area of the glossopharyngeal nerve in the jugular foramen. After passing through the jugular foramen, this glossopharyngeal nerve will exit from the cranial cavity. Now let us explain the extracranial course of glossopharyngeal nerve. After exiting from the cranial cavity through the jugular foramen, the nerve passes downwards and forwards. So here this course will be in between the internal carotid artery and internal jugular vein. So here you can clearly see this is the internal jugular vein and this is the internal carotid artery. So initially this nerve will be between internal carotid artery and internal jugular vein. Further, this glossopharyngeal nerve will run downwards. So you can have a look at this picture. This is internal jugular vein and this is internal carotid artery. So soon after emerging from the jugular foramen, that will be located, the nerve will be located between internal jugular vein and internal carotid artery. Again, the nerve will run further forwards and downwards. Then the nerve will be located between internal carotid artery and external carotid artery. You can clearly see this is the glossopharyngeal nerve. This is between internal carotid artery and external carotid artery respectively. The nerve, you could notice below, this is the hypoglossal nerve. Further, this nerve will be entering to the pharynx by passing a gap between superior and middle constrictor muscle. So the gap between superior and middle constrictor muscle, the glossopharyngeal nerve will enter to the pharyngeal region. And remember, Here the nerve will be accompanying the muscle called as stylopharyngeus muscle. So we have to make out that the structures passing through the gap between superior and middle constrictor muscle. These structures are the stylopharyngeus muscle and its nerve. What is the nerve? Glossopharyngeal nerve. Now let us learn various branches which are arising from the glossopharyngeal nerve. So first to explain is the tympanic branch. This is called as tympanic nerve, or also called as Jacobson's nerve. So this particular nerve here in this picture, you can clearly see this is the tympanic branch or Jacobson's nerve. So this tympanic branch, that is the first branch that leaves the inferior ganglion. So this is the inferior ganglion and this is the branch, tympanic branch, and it enters to a small foramen in the jugular fossa, and that foramen will be leading to the tympanic canaliculus. So through the tympanic canaliculus, this tympanic branch will be reaching to the tympanic cavity or middle ear cavity, and that will form a plexus here. This is called as tympanic plexus, that is in relation with the promontory of the middle ear cavity, that will form tympanic plexus. Remember, this tympanic plexus provides several branches that supply sensory branches to the middle ear cavity and also to the lateral part of the auditory tube or eustachian tube. Further, another branch will be going to the mastoid antrum, that will go behind. So these are some branches from the tympanic plexus. And again, this will join with the lesser petrosal nerve. The lesser petrosal nerve arising from this plexus, tympanic plexus, that will carry the preganglionic secretomotor fibers to the parotid gland. So these preganglionic secretomotor fibers are reaching to the otic ganglion, and it will relay the further through the auriculotemporal nerve. These fibers are reaching to the parotid gland, that is secretomotor fibers to the parotid gland. Next branch is carotid branch. So the carotid branch, this is also called as carotid sinus nerve. So here in this picture, this is the sinus nerve. As the name suggests you, that will be entering to the, that will be arising from the inferior level, from the level which is inferior to the ganglion. Further, it will supply the carotid sinus and carotid body. If you trace, you can clearly see that will be supplying to the carotid body and carotid sinus here. So here, the carotid body contains the chemoreceptors, and together with the aortic body, it monitors the carbon dioxide concentration in the blood. Next is pharyngeal branches. So as the name suggests you, the pharyngeal branches arises in the pharyngeal wall, and these are uniting with the pharyngeal branch of vagus nerve and pharyngeal branch of sympathetic cervical ganglia. Further, this pharyngeal nerve supplies the pharyngeal mucosa via this pharyngeal plexus. So here in this picture, these are the pharyngeal branches. Next is branch to the stylopharyngeus. Already we have mentioned that these are the motor fibers which are supplying to the muscle called as stylopharyngeus. So other than these, we have to mention the branches like tonsillar branches and lingual branches. So the tonsillar branches, as the name suggests you, that will supply to the palatine tonsil to carry the sensations from palatine tonsil. Further, the lingual branches, that will be supplying to the mucosa of the posterior one third of the tongue and also to the circumvallate papillae, that is in front of sulcus terminalis. So these are the branches from the glossopharyngeal nerve. At the end, let us discuss some clinical anatomy related to the glossopharyngeal nerve. So first to explain is the gag reflex. So the gag reflex is elicited by applying stimulus to the posterior pharyngeal wall or to the soft palate. So if we apply any stimulant to this soft palate or to the posterior pharyngeal wall, this will result in elevation of the pharynx and also the elevation of soft palate and retraction of tongue. So this is the process of gag reflex. So in this reflex, the afferent limb of this reflex is glossopharyngeal nerve. So here is the picture. So you can clearly see the afferent fibers, the sensations are carried through the ninth cranial nerve. So that will reach to the center, and further the afferent impulses are coming through the vagus nerve. Afferent impulses are coming through the vagus nerve on either side. And remember, the gag reflex will be lost if any injury happened to the glossopharyngeal nerve or to the vagus nerve. Next, let us see various injuries that can happen to the glossopharyngeal nerve or the effect of injury to the glossopharyngeal nerve. If injury happened to the glossopharyngeal nerve, there will be absence of secretions from the parotid gland, because already earlier we have seen that the glossopharyngeal nerve carries the secretomotor pathway to the parotid gland. So any injury to this glossopharyngeal nerve that can happen, loss of secretion of saliva from the parotid gland or diminished secretion from the parotid gland. And also there will be absence of taste from the posterior one-third of the tongue and also circumvallant papillae. So this also already we have seen, because the glossopharyngeal nerve carries the taste sensation from the posterior one-third of the tongue and from the circumvallant papillae. Again, there will be loss of pain sensation from the tongue, tonsil, pharynx, soft palate also. Then the gag reflex will be absent. So these are some manifestations of injury to the glossopharyngeal nerve. Next condition to explain is glossopharyngeal neuralgia. So in glossopharyngeal neuralgia, there will be sharp, severe attack of the pain affecting the posterior part of the pharynx and also the tonsillar area. Next, jugular foramen syndrome. So this syndrome can happen due to injury to the jugular foramen. But remember, there will be involvement of multiple nerves, like other cranial nerves, like vagus nerve and also the accessory nerves. Because already in detail we have seen that in the jugular foramen, these nerves are, three nerves are together. Next is referred pain to the ear in pharyngitis. Remember, if pharyngitis, inflammation of the pharynx happens, there will be referred pain to the ear cavity also, because the same nerve is innervating the middle ear cavity also. So this is another clinical aspect related to the glossopharyngeal nerve.